different music, because I think that just hypes you up. It's so good to see you this morning. We had a cool morning. I had ice on my windshield this morning. I didn't think it got that cold, but there was some ice on my windshield from somewhere. Won't you stand with us this morning, and let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we're going to sing some songs to honor Him and worship Him this morning and lift Him up. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, what a privilege it is to be gathered together with the church, our brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for this property and facility you've provided for us to do so. I pray that our words, our listening, our giving, our fellowship with one another, just our time in general here would be honoring to you, Lord. And I pray that we would listen to the words as we sing them and as we hear them, that it would change our lives, that you would transform us by the renewing of our minds in the presence of the Holy Spirit as we go out from this place throughout the week. Have your will and way here today, Lord, in Jesus' name. You'll remain standing and let's sing a couple songs.
Solid ground. pray, Father, that you bless the tithes and offering and use them for your further honor, Lord. For we ask all this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Is one of the remotest areas in Ilocano. There is no electricity, no running water, no infrastructure in the area. But because Operation Christmas Child, the gift boxes were brought to the area, and as a result, a church was built.
It's slippery, it's muddy, it's physically challenging.
We appreciate our ministry partners and volunteers in this area who hike for 1.5 hours every Saturday to go and teach the children in Barangay Tibina.
Pastor, ako din sa Regional Baptist Church. In the area, outreach ang Regional Baptist Church. Nabudlayan pa man kami mag-ipon sa mga tao kaya hindi pa rin ako naka-open ang mga tao ulit. Sa pag-risk ang mga tao, hindi mo dahil basta-basta mapapati. Tungod sa ang poverty nila, tungod sa nila ang mga sitwasyon, and it comes to the operation of Christmas Child. Nag-open siya sa door. Nung umpisa nakapalapit, nagbukas man sa disenta, sa una-una ko sa hearts ng mga tao ulit.
The
greatest journey. I mean, amo to siya ang amo niya nilingkay sa pag-disciple, sa pag-tulog sa mga kabataan. So nakita namo na namo parents na nag-enjoy. And then that's the beginning. I-gather ko at ipunan ko ang mga parents. And we will have our own Bible classes. Ama-tama. Nag-grow ang ministry.
Ang gagit pag-bago ng dae. Te, sa una, huwag simbahan doon. Huwag na tayo naman ang mga tao. Te, anay nyo may simbahan doon. Te, nami, nag-simba. Nag-ipayit kami kaya pati ang mga bata.
Through Operation Christmas Child, we see how evangelism, discipleship, and multiplication is taking place. Each of these gift boxes is a gospel opportunity that reach the children in the remotest areas of the Philippines.
That should just lighten your heart, bring a smile to your face. What a privilege and honor we have today to take part in that ministry. We have visitors with us today, and I see some folks here for the first time. A lot of you have been here before. You're here for a special day, whether you knew that coming in or not. We get to commission, pray over these boxes as they will be sent out soon. Some have still to finish packing their boxes, so this Thursday we will be taking those. So if you still have boxes to pack, you're welcome to do that. Just make sure they're back here by Wednesday. Thursday morning we'll be taking them. If you brought a box that's not filled yet or partially filled, hold on to it. We'll pray over it, anoint it, and then you can take it back with you and finish packing. I wanted to read something to you because in the past we have anointed some supplies that we took up for children, for schools, backpacks, or I can't remember exactly what it was. I think it was backpacks, but I want to let you know why we do this. Back in Exodus chapter 30, verse 22, we find these words. Moreover, the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, take also for yourself the finest of spices, a flowing myrrh, 500 shekels, and a fragrant cinnamon, half as much, 250, and a fragrant cane, 250, and acacia, 500, according to the shekel of the sanctuary, and of olive oil, a hin. And you shall make of these a holy anointing oil, a perfume mixture, the work of a perfumer. It shall be a holy anointing oil. And with it you shall anoint the tent of meeting, and the ark of the testimony, and the table, and all its utensils, and the lampstand, and its utensils, the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering, and all its utensils, and the laver, its stand. The laver is where the priest washed his hands and his feet. You shall also consecrate them that they may be most holy. Whatever touches them shall be holy. There's a definition that I looked up in one of the Bible apps that explains it a little further. It says, anointing is a way of making holy. The Messiah means the anointed one. And olive oil was consecrated as a way of showing that something is more than just what it is. Anointing with consecrated oil dedicates people and things as a way of making something dedicated to God and holy. That's what we want to do today. These are more than Christmas gifts. They're more than just toys or books or clothing or whatever's inside them. They are an opportunity for people to hear the gospel, to hear about Jesus. A lot of them for the first time. So I ask you to help us this morning. I want to ask our children if they would come and help. They're going to hand out the boxes. And I want all the boxes in someone's hands. So you may have two, you may have to help another person hold one, but I want all the boxes in someone's hands. So the children are going to help. Y'all can stand where you are, you can come down in front, and we are going to anoint each box. So I'll walk you through that in just a second. So let's hand these out. If you're willing to participate, you can come on down to the front. If you want to stay where you are, but yet you want a box, just raise your hand and we'll try to get that to you.
Jalen.
Thank you. You guys want a box? Make sure every box is in someone's hands. And if you want to participate where you are, just stand or raise your hand. Yo, there's some folks in the back that if we can take a box back here. A box or two to those seeing if they would like to participate, that would be great.
Take the last one, okay.
Some of these are not wrapped, so be careful not to spill. Some of them are quite full. If they don't have a rubber band, just hold them tight. Don't let them fall over. Make sure everyone has one that would like one, and then we'll double up if we need to. I'm going to start making my way around with the olive oil, anointing the boxes. Just kind of help me, let me know which ones have not been anointed. So if I come to you and aren't been anointed, just let me know. Share with me. Grab one. Can I steal one? Thank you. Thank you. there are countless stories of children opening these boxes and being so excited. Not only have they not seen the toys within the boxes, they've never received a present, much less know what Christmas is about. There's so many stories of those occasions, and when they do this, they always share the gospel. They always share the gospel. Many times it's the children that run back to their hut or their home or wherever it is, and they tell their parents, and their parents hear about Jesus for the first time. So this is a gift that is far-reaching, and we want to pray over that right now. So let's do that as I pray. You pray as well. Heavenly Father, what a privilege you've given us this morning. Thank you, Lord, that these gifts we hold in our hands have been set aside, prayed over, consecrated, anointed for the purpose of holiness, to present the gospel that you may transform lives, that you may prepare people for eternity. We know that these boxes could go anywhere in this world and far-reaching places that are hard to get to children and families that have never received a present and have never heard of Jesus. Thank you for giving us the privilege, a wonderful privilege, of taking part in this ministry. Lord, may these boxes and the contents therein be glorifying and honoring to you. Amen. And may these children that hold these boxes and the families that get to see what's inside, hear of you, and enjoy maybe for the first time understanding that the Savior of the world loves them, died for them, gave everything for them, as we've already sung about. I thank you for giving us the opportunity to share in that, and I just pray, Father, that your presence, your power would go forth as these gifts are taken around the world. Please protect those who are delivering them. As we just saw, it's not a matter of just getting on a bus or in a car. Sometimes it's walking or on a mule or a horseback or in a boat or whatever. Lord, I pray that you protect them as they deliver the gospel literally around the world. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Put the boxes back. Christmas is the next day. That's what it seems like, at least. Things move rapidly this time of the year. So keep that in mind. That seems like we go from hot August, the heat of August to, you know, it's Christmas Eve. Take every day, one day at a time. Enjoy the day. Embrace the day. Serve in that day. Let's not throw the days away waiting for what comes in a week or 2 weeks down the road. If you will notice there in the listings of events, first of all, today, Sandy put that in there about our housewarming. Appreciate that. Looking forward to seeing folks there today. I would reiterate, please do not bring gifts. I know housewarming, that's usually the thing y'all have given and given to us. You took up a love offering while we were building the house. You just honored us during Pastor Appreciation Month. We just want to see faces, okay? And somebody else is providing the food, so you can come and just hang out with us a little bit. We'd appreciate that. Look at the ministry opportunity there to donate cleaning supplies and so forth for teams that are still helping with hurricane victims in the mountains. So please contact Tony or Diane if you have have any of those? Diane, Tony, can y'all raise your hand back there? Just raise, there you go. Back there, that's Tony and Diane. They, you want to sing a song or something? Okay. Church family Thanksgiving meal. This is very important because it's different than we've done in the past. That's right. We do different things every once in a while. We're going to have our Thanksgiving meal November the 24th, next Sunday. The difference is it's in the morning instead of in the evening. Our morning worship service will be our popcorn testimony time. So, and some songs, and then we will eat afterwards. And as the bulletin says, we meet and have fellowship during the service. When you come in here next Sunday, it will be set up in banquet style, as it is at homecoming, at round tables and different chairs. During the worship service, we will focus on worshiping God, giving Him praise, thanksgiving for what He's done in the past year. And then we will move to a time of eating. The two shall not mix. This Sunday is praise time, worship time, thanksgiving, okay, and then afterwards. And the details are there as what to bring, what the church will provide, and so forth. Shepherd's Table Food Pantry needs some plastic bags. They're always in need of plastic bags. Please bring those. There's a box back there for those, just in front of the sound booth there. Also, since Shepherd's Table is undergoing new direction, new management, and they may be in need of some food and other things as well. I think you can check on Facebook with the needs from the Shepherd's Table, and I think we're supposed to serve this Thursday. Is this the third Thursday? No? Yeah. Yes?
I see Facebook.
Okay. Just check. We'll find out what the needs are, if there's extra needs, some things that we're not aware of. Yeah, it's the 21st, this Thursday. Meals on Wheels food drive. Please continue to keep that in mind. Bring things. There are three boxes back there in front of the sound booth, so keep that in mind. I think there's three. And you will see this announcement about our parking lot ongoing as we endeavor to get this corrected and the new parking lot. There's signs out there. Be careful as you walk, not to trip, not to hurt yourself. So be aware that there are some trip hazards, and we want just to make you informed of that. On the back, we have many prayer requests, praises, and so forth. Please continue to remember those on our list that have been there. Several that are going through tests, surgeries, treatments. A lot of things, some things have changed. Brother Barry Wagner is now at Tidelands in Merle's Inlet. He was at Conway, and he is there at Tidelands, hopes to go home, but from what I saw the other day, they said maybe Friday before he can go home, so pray for Barry and keep him in your prayers. We had several people that had some surgery here recently, skin cancer surgery and different things. Lift each other up as the Lord brings a name to your mind. Some that have lost loved ones this past week. Just a lot of different things, a lot of different needs there. So continue to lift these folks up in prayer. Having tests this week, even tomorrow, and otherwise. So keep those folks in your prayers. This is a different service, and for a lot of reasons. We're going to sing a song in a moment, and then we're going to dive into Luke 2 again. And then at the end of our service, we're going to do something very special. We're going to pray over someone who has requested that the church do so. So I want to let you know that, and I'll walk you through a little bit of scripture in that at the end of the sermon. So let you know that, give you the details a little bit later on. So at this time, we're going to sing Wonderful, Merciful Savior. He is indeed. So if you agree with that, sing. Make a joyful noise. Okay, let's stand and sing together. Wonderful, Merciful Savior. biggest money, that it's in the place that we sing the words, hopelessly we've lost our way, that we lost our way in that verse. I don't know if you realize that or not, but we were behind a couple beats there and just thought it's just an emphasis on the words.
I was right on time.
You were right on time. Okay. Those of you that are just visiting with us today, maybe for the first time, and wonder why we're in Christmas text and it's November, just how it just falls, because we've been studying Luke and just where we are presently and studying God's Word. I have some interesting things to share with you today about this passage. Maybe answers to some questions you may have had in the past about this passage. We're in Luke 2. And we're just going to start with verse 39 and finish out the chapter. So if you'll go to Luke 2 and verse 39, that would be most helpful. When you're there, just look up and smile. Some of you tell a story. All right, good. Here we go. Luke 2, 39. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own city of Nazareth. And the child continued to grow and become strong, increasing in wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now, who are we talking about here?
Jesus.
So we started out talking about Mary and Joseph, and now it's ending there with Jesus. Increasing in wisdom, the grace of God was upon him. And we will come back to that statement. That statement causes us to stumble sometimes. Verse 41, and his parents used to go to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of Passover. And when he became 12, they went up there according to the custom of the feast. And as they were returning after spending the full number of days, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. His parents were unaware of it, but supposed him to be in the caravan and went a day's journey. And they began looking for him among their relatives and acquaintances. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem looking for him. You get the picture, 12-year-old boy. Lost, okay? They don't know where he is. They traveled for a day. They turn around and come back. And it came about after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. And all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. Now, here's the parents' point of view. And when they saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us this way? Behold, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you." Now, we know how that conversation would go if it was us, okay? We might not say exactly those things, but it would be similar. And he said to them, "Why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my father's house?" And they did not understand the statement which he had made to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth, and he continued in subjection to them, and his mother treasured all the things in her heart. And Jesus kept increasing in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. So a couple things about this that I want you to hear and understand. In verse 39 it says, when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own city of Nazareth, and the child continued to grow and become strong, increasing in wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And I always read that thinking, why does he need unmerited favor? Is Jesus. Well, in this passage, and the verse that it ends with, it's talking about charis. It's not unmerited favor. It is simply favor of God. I'll give you a better definition here. Graciousness, the divine influence upon the heart and its reflection in the life, including gratitude, the benefit, favor, gift, joy, liberality, pleasure. Charis is different. It's just God's favor was upon him. It wasn't unmerited favor because he's Jesus. He didn't need anything unmerited. He's perfect. It's God's favor was upon him. And he's growing like a normal child. Sometimes we hyper-spiritualize things that are not meant to be in Scripture. He's a 12-year-old boy. He's growing. Yes, he's God in the flesh. His body, his mind are developing just like a 12-year-old boy would here, as we know it, okay? So he's growing. And his parents used to go to Jerusalem, verse 41, every year at the Feast of Passover, and when he became 12 and went up there according to the custom of the feast, and as they were returning, let me stop there just a second. First of all, This is according to what we know as the Old Testament, and it took a few days. Now, the days of Passover, there were 8 days in all, but 1 day for killing the Paschal lamb, 7 days for the observance of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So 8 days they had observed the feast and taken part in the Passover. And verse 43 says, "And as they were returning after spending the full number of days, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem. And his parents were unaware of it." Now, you may say, how is that possible? Well, remember, and it says here in the text, and a lot of historians and commentators just reiterate this, they were traveling in a huge group. They were traveling about 70 miles. Not in a car, not on a train, not on a bus. Okay? They were walking or riding on animals for 70 miles. And they were in a large caravan. They traveled with loved ones, acquaintances, neighbors. They all had to go for the Passover. So it was a large crowd, and it was not uncommon for them to may have laid eyes on Jesus or their child, whomever that would be, and say, okay, they're with the group, and we head out. They traveled a day's journey. You know how children are. They kind of huddle up. They hide. Sometimes they do. But they play together. They're going to do their own thing. They'll be with you, but they just kind of playing over here and over there. Well, they traveled for a day, and then at night they realized he's not with us. His parents were unaware of it. Verse 44, but supposed him to be in the caravan and went a day's journey. And they began looking for him among their relatives and acquaintances, and when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem looking for him. Now, remember, a day's journey back, okay? When it says 3 days, it's just like Jesus died on the cross, 3 days later he rose. We've always kind of had that figured in our head, that how is that possible? He died on Friday, he rose on Sunday. 3 days later, that's not 3 days. In ancient times, in biblical days, it literally meant touched. It touched 3 days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It touched 3 days. That's what it means here. A day's journey out, a day's journey back, they found him the next day. It touched 3 days. And when they did not find him, they returned to Jerusalem looking for him. And it came about after 3 days, they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the teachers, both listening to them and asking them questions. When I was studying this, I ran across something that never run across my mind. I never thought of this, because he's the Savior of the world. When it says in the temple, he was actually in the court of the temple, because Jesus didn't belong to the Levitical priest. He was not a Levitical priest. Could not enter the temple itself. Isn't that ironic? He couldn't enter the temple because he wasn't of Levitical heritage. See, he was in the court, in the outer court, the court of the temple. Verse 47, and all who heard him were amazed at his understanding and his answers. When they saw him, his parents saw him, they were astonished. And his mother said to him, son, why have you treated us this way? Behold, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you. I remember a time that I got lost because I wasn't paying attention in the grocery store when I was a kid. And I didn't get this speech. I got another speech. Y'all ever had that speech when you were little? You know, I told you to stay right here. And where did you go? And, you know, you're supposed to be holding my hand. You get distracted. You know, that's why they put candy at the checkouts, to distract kids. You do know that, don't you? Well, Mary is being an earthly mother, a normal mother. She's lost her 12-year-old son, who the angels gave her. You think about losing someone, she has lost the Son of God. And she is just beside herself. There's an emphasis here in the original language. It means not just anxious, but anxious with sorrow, anxious with heaviness. And they were desperately looking for their child. So she comes and says, son, why have you treated us this way? Behold, your father and I have been anxiously looking for you. That's a normal parent's response, right? But here's Jesus' response. It's quite different than a normal 12-year-old boy. He says to them, why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my father's house? Now there's some things here I'd like to explain to you. It's pretty interesting. How is it? When Jesus says this, it's, why have you sought me with so much anxiety? Listen to what he says. This is the explanation through the Greek here. Mary should have known that the Son of God was safe. This is a commentary. She should have known that some God was safe, that his heavenly Father would take care of him, and that he could do nothing amiss. How many times have we put people in the hands of God with our prayers and then worried about them? Okay? We do that. This is the Son of God. Jesus says, why would you be worried about me? Didn't you know I have to be about the Father's business? The translation here is really interesting as well, because, well, let me just hold on just a second. It says, you have reason to know. When Jesus says, didn't you know, why is it that you were looking for me? You should have known. And it was the emphasis or the insinuation. You had reason to know. You knew my design coming into the world, and that design was superior to the duty of obeying earthly parents, and they should be willing always to give me up to the proper business for which I live. When I read that, and that's from a commentator about this passage, I thought about priorities in our lives. Now, we're talking about the Son of God, obviously, in this passage, God incarnate. But in our own lives, who is first? Are we about our Father's business first, or in the things of my Father first, and then in the things of family and friends and employers and church and everything else? There's a standard here that's set. There's an order of priority that is still true today in our lives, just as it was with Jesus. He wasn't being disrespectful. He never sinned. He wasn't trying to dishonor his parents or come back at them in a way that was sassy or sarcastic. He was simply stating a point. You know that I will be in the business of my Father, in the activities and the things of my Father, more so than in the things of my family. Okay? I want you to grab a hold of that, because so many times family is top. Family is important. I say this so many times because God created family. It's important. But a lot of times the church will sacrifice the things of God for the things of family. Amen. That's a good place for amen. Because many times we have things, ministries going on, important things happening, and people will say, well, have family members come into town. Please don't shoot me or throw things. I've done the same thing. I've had the same thing happen to me. That's a great opportunity to say, on Sundays and Wednesdays, I'm worshiping the Lord corporately with my brothers and sisters. I'd love for you to join us. If you can't, fine, make yourself at home here. I'll be back in a couple hours. It's just a couple hours. Well, serving God and the church are two different things. They're tied together at the heart.
Amen. Okay?
So many times, family comes first in our lives, and it ought not be. And there are other scriptures that teach us very clearly about this priority. And Jesus says, in verse 49, why is it that you were looking for me? Did you not know that I had to be in my Father's house? And the word there, house, is translated that way because he was in the temple or the court of the temple. But the literal translation is what I have up there, in the things of my Father. Did you not know that I had to be in the things of my Father? Do we ever get distracted from the things of our Father? We get distracted from political issues. From elections. We get distracted from church issues, from family things, from health issues. We get distracted from the things of my Father, of our Father. And it ought not be. As Jesus says, the things of the Father should come first. Look at verse 50, if you would. It says, and they did not understand the statement which he had made to them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and continued in subjection or subordination to them. And his mother treasured all the things in her heart. And Jesus kept increasing in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. And that's the same exact word as charis that I talked about at the beginning. Favor with God is his pouring out his presence, his joy, his benefit of knowing him, the divine influence on Jesus. That, not unmerited favor, but that is charis. It's a different word. One of the commentators wrote this about verse 49 and following. It says, my Father's business, some think that this should be translated in my Father's house, which a lot of translators do. That's in the temple. Jesus reminded them here that he came down from heaven, that he had a higher Father than an earthly parent, that even in earthly life, it was proper that he should be engaged in the work for which he came. Why are we here? What's the most important reason that we are here?
Worship. Worship.
Yes, we're here to worship God, and that, and obedience to Him, that is proper worship. Obedience to God is worship. Following Him, trusting Him, submitting to Him, that's the most important thing we're about today in this life. No matter what it is, in our work, in our play, in our families, in our friends, in our church situations, it is always to honor and worship Him through our lives. Through our lives. That's, a lot of times in our prayers we say, this is our worship service together as brothers and sisters, but service, ministry and service, a lot of times begins when we leave this building.
Amen.
The church goes out. The light of the Lord is in us, and we go out into the darkened world, just like these presents here, symbolically, into a world that needs to see the light, needs to hear the truth. So service begins when we leave the building. In a lot of ways, as we come in contact with others, we are ambassadors. We are sent out as ambassadors. Jesus was making that statement and reminding His earthly parents. Now, it's important that we read that last the last couple of verses because He lived in subjection to His parents as a obedient child should do. He did not disobey His parents. He did not say, well, I'm God in skin. I'll just, you know, whatever. These are the years that why people say Jesus was a carpenter, because it was Jewish tradition for the son, especially the firstborn, to follow after the trade of his father. So between the time he was 12 and the time he was 30, most likely, he was doing carpentry work in the shadow of his father, his earthly father, Joseph. And you know what I'm saying, earthly father, in the way that we understand in Scripture. He only has one father. So, we ever get distracted? Are we reminded of our true meaning for being here? The reason that you and I go through every day. When we go to work, it's not to make money, although money is great to make and it pays the bills and it's nice to have. We go to work to be ambassadors. We go to our hobbies. Why do we go to hobbies? Because we need some exercise. Yes, we do need exercise, but that's not why we go participate in our hobbies. We go there as ambassadors. I'm going to use Sue Ellen as an example. Sue told me a little story this morning about someone that she ran into. They had a little short conversation, and in that conversation, she made a comment about the Lord. And before the conversation was over, he said, you gave me something to think about. She was in the workplace. I've heard other stories, other people talking about in the workplace or standing in line at the store, wherever we are ambassadors. Jesus made it clear. We are in the things of our Father. We are to be about the things of our Father primarily, above anything and everything else. As you go, make disciples. And that's why it's important to see that as present tense in Matthew 28. As you go, make disciples. Wherever you are. That's our number one problem. To spread the gospel, to spread the light. I am going to end it right here for now, from our sermon perspective. And those of you that are following us on Facebook, we are going to stop our streaming right now.